Hello everyone. So this video is for the students who have already taken our courses or the students who are planning to take our courses. Now in this video I am specifying how can you take the maximum benefit from our courses and how can you refer those courses to get better ranks in your examination or to get better knowledge from the course itself. Okay. So I'm going to discuss the various factors and parameters which can be related to how you can ask your doubts, how you can get the updates to the video lectures, and apart of this, what should be your study methodology, in which order you can follow the subjects, and how you can get maximum benefit from the entire course itself. Now, so I should name this video as how to successfully learn from our courses. So I definitely recommend you that before you start watching any lecture, first go through this lecture, because in this lecture I'm going to give you some guidelines regarding how you can ask the doubts, what is the procedures that you have to follow, and what is the some of the rules and regulations that you can follow so that you can learn better and we both can have a better communication with each other. Because most of the time students generally ask very silly questions which is already specified. So I should not say silly, they're silly in some sense because we already tell them how to do it, but the problem is they do not even read the instructions that is given by us, they do not even watch the videos that for the instruction that is given by us. Before even watching any kind of video, they start asking the questions which is already specified in the video itself, which is already specified for the course itself. Okay. So how to successfully complete our course and how to successfully learn from our courses. So first thing is, first and foremost thing is, if you want to prepare from our courses, then the best thing that I can advise you is to get is to do hard work. Okay. So there is no alternative to hard work. Generally, what happens is, if you ask other students who are already who already succeeded in the examination, you will get various opinions. Some of the students may say that they have studied 1 hour a day, 2 hours a day, that's it. And some students may say that they have studied for 12 hours a day for last 2 years or 3 years to crack the examination. So never copy other students, first of all. Never get confused because of other students, because whatever worked for them, it may not work for you. Because you are having your own mind and capability, you are having your own background, you are having your own set of knowledge. Whatever things you know, he may not know. Whatever things he know, then you may not know. So it depends on students to students, how they gather knowledge, how they perceive things, and accordingly you can make your own plan and strategy to crack the examination. Now what happens is, generally students ask this question a lot of times. Sir, can you give me a preparation plan to study for the next 4 months to crack the examination? Now, my very simple answer is that if I make a preparation plan, that preparation plan may be valid for me, but that preparation plan may not be valid for you. Why? Because some of the subjects that you already know, you already feel that you are very confident in those subjects, or you're already having some background knowledge in those subjects, then why do you want to waste time in those particular subjects? For example, if I say that to complete one subject you need 10 days, I'll give you a plan where I'm going to say you are going to study data structures, and for data structures you are going to spend 10 days, for algorithms you are going to spend 10 days, for operating system you are going to spend 10 days, and so on. I'm going to make a plan like this for you. But the problem is, you know that for data structure you don't need 10 days, you can even finish the data structure subject within 4 to 5 days. So why are you wasting 10 days in that? So the preparation plan, generally, if you start studying by yourself, if you start going through the videos by yourself, then you can make your preparation plan by yourself, because you know yourself better. I don't know what is going on internally you, I don't know what is going on around you, what is your I should say environment, because generally you might be a student who is studying in the college, you might be a student who is a dropout, or you might be a professional who is working in the industry from a long time, or you might be a faculty or assistant professor or professor in some colleges. So it totally depends on you, what is your preparation, what is your level of preparation. So I feel that it is you who can judge yourself better. I cannot judge you better. That is why if you want a preparation plan, just do one thing, start studying the subject, go through the one subject, at least go through one or two subject or three subjects, then you feel that how much more time you need to devote to finish the syllabus, and secondly, how much more topics that you have to learn to finish the syllabus, that is totally dependent on you. So you can make your own preparation plan according to that. Okay. Now, secondly, a part of this is what learning strategy you can follow. Learning strategy that you can follow. Now, there are two kinds of learning strategy, but I will say is number one is the depth first learning strategy. Depth first learning strategy. And number two is the breadth first learning strategy. Breadth first learning strategy. So what is a depth first learning strategy and what is the breadth first learning strategy? Is generally what happens is there are some students, if I give you any topic, let us say it is programming and data structures. Now, in programming and data structures, the first chapter of the programming data structures is introduction. The second chapter is conditional statements, which is if, else, loop, for loop, while loop, and third chapter is about pointers. Now, the problem is when students start studying in a depth first manner, they are going to spend so much time in the first chapter, that is introduction, that they till the time they reach through the second or third chapter, they are already exhausted. So they, you don't actually have to spend so much time in one topic that you don't you're not able to study the other topics. Now, examinations like UGC NET, it is having 23 subjects. Remember, when I'm saying 23, there are two key differences between GATE and UGC NET. In GATE, you have only 12 subjects, and in UGC NET, you have 23 subjects, which and a paper one is also extra part of that. Now, in GATE, you can afford to go in depth in one topic, but in UGC NET, you cannot afford to go in depth in one topic. Now, there may be some subject where I might have left one or two topics. That is intentional most of the times. Why it is intentional is because if you are going to study everything in one subject, then what happens is in other subject, you will not be able to finish the other subject. So the main key idea is to finish all the subjects. See, in UGC NET examination, they are not asking you to score 100% in the examination. What they are asking is that you should be able to clear the cutoff for assistant professor and you should be able to clear the cutoff for JRF. Now, in case of assistant professor, the cutoff this year was 56% and for JRF it was 60%. In the same way, in case of GATE, the cutoff for the top 300 ranks is around 60 to 65% only. Okay. Now, in UGC NET, the number of subjects is so much that even you can leave one or two topics in one subject, but you have to finish all the subjects. You have to study and go through all the subjects at least once. So there may be some topics that you might not find that I'm going to upload a later point of time, but you can skip that part. If that topic is not available, just skip it, keep it in mind, note it somewhere down there that this topic is not there. Might be within next 1 or 2 days, within next 1 week or 2 weeks, I'm going to upload the topic itself because constantly I'm recording the videos. And when you've taken this course, I have allocated you around 4,000 plus videos. Now, you cannot watch all those 4,000 videos in 3 months or 4 months, right? It needs time to process all the videos. It needs time to prepare notes for all those videos. So you have to go through every video at least once. And I suggest you that to crack any examination, you have to revise the entire syllabus for at least 3 times. This is a key rule which I generally follow, that before going to any examination, whether it is a university examination, whether it is any kind of competitive examination, you have to follow every subject at least 3 times. If you study at least every subject at least 3 times, then you will be able to retain it for longer duration of times. So, which is also very necessary. So, never follow a depth first strategy in case of UGC NET or even in case of GATE, because if you go through one topic and one subject in so much depth, you will not be able to find any energy to study any other subject. Okay. So first of all, always follow the breadth first strategy and then follow the onion kind of strategy, onion peeling kind of strategy. So what is the onion peeling kind of strategy? So what is an onion peeling strategy is that if you see an onion, there are various layers over an onion. You have to peel the first layer, then you have to peel the second layer, then you have to peel the third layer and fourth layer and so on until you reach the core. In the same way, never go to the depth first strategy because you cannot finish the entire syllabus because of depth first. Always follow the breadth first search in onion peeling kind of strategy. go through all the subject at least once, whatever content has been covered, whatever topics that is covered by me, just finish everything, all the subjects, then again come back and then again revise, because till that time I must have added more topics to that. Again come back and then again revise, then again come back and then again revise, at least revise for 3 times. So always study like in an onion peeling strategy. Okay. And the third thing that I can suggest you here is that please make the notes. So it is please make the notes. Okay. Now, this is a basic problem, is that when you write something by yourself, in that way you are able to retain it for a longer duration of time. Now, I can give you any books, I can give you my own notes, my own handwritten notes, but the problem is you'll not be able to remember them for a long time. What I suggest is, please make notes for every video, because that will help you in terms of your revision. And secondly, I'm going to provide you the question banks. So I personally prefer to provide more question banks rather than providing handwritten notes of myself or notes of any subject by myself. So I don't prefer that, because that way you'll not be able to remember it for a long time. I prefer that I provide you as much as questions as possible to practice as much as possible. I'll provide you the solutions of those questions, but I'll refrain myself for providing to the notes for the topics at this current moment. Okay. And the third thing is, the fourth thing is the content organization. Content organization and studying strategy. So what do you mean by content organization? Is, see, there are subjects that are interrelated to each other. Now, for example, I'll just give you some examples of the subjects. For example, C programming, data structures and algorithm. So you cannot study data structures unless you study C programming. In the same way, you cannot study algorithm unless you study data structures, because to study these topics, it is necessary to finish all these three subjects. In the same way, you have to study digital logic, then you can go for computer architecture organization, and then you can go for operating system. So there may be subjects that are interdependent on each other. So if you directly go and jump to any specific subject, for example, if you directly go and jump to operating system, then I feel 99% of the times you'll not be able to grab the full knowledge out of that particular course. Why? Because you might have missed some concept which is from digital logic, might have missed some concept which is from computer architecture and organization. So I have already created a video about how to follow the lectures. Just go through that video, because in that video I have already specified in which order you have to follow the subjects so that you can get the maximum knowledge out of the entire course. This is my personal strategy, this is my personal suggestion. Don't go and jump to any random subject, because that way you will create a problem for yourself as well as you will create a problem for ourselves also, because you will not be able to handle even silly intuitive things. And sometimes the students end up asking very silly doubts, because that is already covered in the videos. So always cover the content and the video lectures in the sequence that I have provided. At the same time, always study in a sequential manner, because that way, because I tried to cover every topic in a story like fashion. So every topic that you are going to study, there will be a story behind it from the previous video. So I try to cover the course in such a way that you are going to study the subjects like you are reading a storybook. Okay, so that is why it is better to cover the content in a sequential fashion in the topics, in the subjects, according to the subjects that I have specified. Okay, that way you will be able to learn from a more in a better way. And number 5 is that how you are going to retain the topics for more time. For that, you can study the Feynman technique. So it is a very important technique. I mean, generally, this technique is a very famous technique to learn and grab the things. So what is this Feynman technique? As you can see over the screen. So number one is pick and study a topic. This is already shown in the screen in front of you. Pick and study a topic. Number two, explain the topic to someone who is naive person, I mean, who doesn't even know the topic and who is unfamiliar with the topic, and at their level and make it, make the topic so simple that that person can also understand it in the simplest language possible. And the step three is identify that, have you left any gaps in your understanding? Is there any gaps in your understanding? If there's any kind of gaps in your understanding, then try and fulfill those gaps. And then again, you return back to your studies, fulfill those gaps and follow the same procedure. Now what happens is, with this procedure, you will be able to retain the topic from a, for a long duration of time, and 99% of the times, you are going to clear your own doubts. You are not clearing the doubts of that person, you are clearing your own doubts. So that is why Feynman technique is a very important technique that you can use while you are studying. Okay? And number four, as actually number six, is the interval of revision. Interval of revision. So this interval of revision is generally very, you know, it depends on people to person how long you can retain. But what I suggest is you have to revise every subject at least three times. Revise every subject at least three times. Now, in the screen in front of you, I've shown a graph. This graph is telling you recall percentage. Recall percentage means when you're studying a topic, at, for example, in starting, you're going to, you can recall the topic for 100%. But next day, when you come back and you try to recall that, then there's some specific percentage. For example, you can only recall the same topic for only 40%. Now, what you have to do is, you have to study the topic again, and you have to again take your recall percentage to 100%. Again, come back after a few days, 2, 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, and when you feel that you are forgetting the topic, then again recall it, again revise it, and then again continue like this. So this is very important, because what you can do is, for a, let us say you are studying a topic today. So you have studied today, after 1 week, revise it again. After 1 month, revise it again. So before going to the examination, at least, you have to revise the topic for three times, because that way you will be able to remember it for a very long duration of time. Number seven is create a fixed study hours. Fixed study hours. So why I'm saying fixed study hours is because when you study on a variable study hours, then you're not going to feel comfortable with remembering the topics. What happens is that if you have fixed study hours, that means if you're maintaining discipline, it can be early morning. Some students are studying 4 a.m. till 10 a.m. or 8 a.m., 4 hours in the morning. Some students are studying at the late night. Maybe it is 10 p.m. to 1 a.m. Right, so you might be studying in early morning or you might be studying at late night. So that is your personal choice. I'll not recommend you, because it totally depends on the person, how much you can make yourself disciplined for that strategy. So, but you have, what you have to do is, every day when you are studying, make a fixed study hours and never disturb it. For example, if you are studying at 4 a.m. till 10 a.m. in the morning, that is 6 hours. Mind you, 6 hours is a very long time. Now, those 6 hours, keep silence. I mean, never distract yourself in opening Facebook, in watching videos on YouTube, some random videos. Stay focused. And then choose a time in such a way where you have minimum distraction from the outside world. Either you get minimum distraction in the late night, or you get minimum distraction in the early morning. So that totally depends on you. Okay, so for example, generally I might study in the late night or I might study in the early morning, but I have to maintain a very fixed hours that every day I have to study these 4 to 6 hours constantly without any kind of distraction, and I have to study it, I have to maintain a discipline. So that is why always maintain a fixed study hours when you are studying for any kind of competitive examination, because it helps you to retain more, it gives a channel to your energy, as well as it creates, it focuses you to learn more. Okay. Secondly, is eighth thing that I can say is learn to learn by yourself. So what I'm saying is, generally what happens is, when you're studying a certain topic, now students mostly, as soon as you get a doubt, they just shoot an email to us by saying, sir, I cannot find this. But before even sending that email, do you think, can you solve it? I mean, do think by yourself, I mean, think, take some time and think about it, ki, is it necessary to send an email for that particular doubt? Why? Because the mostly the doubts that we get, around 60 to 70% of the doubts that we get, they're already, either they're already answered in the upcoming videos, or they're so silly that even if, for example, if I tell to the student says, oh sir, this I know this, I think I just mistakenly asked you this question. So when you are asking some doubts, first of all, if you get some doubts, try to do a Google search on that. If you do a Google search, you will find out that that doubt has already been answered by someone else. You just take 5 seconds, just take 5 minutes to resolve that doubt before even sending the email. Okay, obviously we are always here to answer your doubts, we are always here to resolve all your queries. This is our duty, this is our job. But if you send us a doubt, then it will take at least 24 hours for us to send you a proper solution, a proper answer to that particular doubt. But you can resolve the same doubt by just doing a simple Google search within 5 minutes, right? So send us the doubts which is genuinely worth asking, because if it is very silly, then obviously I'm going to answer it, that is not a problem. But the thing is, you are going to waste a lot of time in just waiting for the solution of that doubt. Okay, the next thing that I suggest here is how you can ask the queries from us. Queries or doubts or questions. Now there are 3 ways of asking the queries, doubts or questions. Number one, the first and the foremost step is write an email. Whenever you get a doubt, if you get a doubt at a particular question, just write that question or the email and ask your doubts clearly, and in the subject of that email, so whenever you write a subject of the email, in that case write first of all the subject name, then write the topic name, and before this write doubt, subject name, topic name, and then you start writing your doubt in the body of the email, because that way it will help us to channelize the doubt to the concerned faculty. So generally for every faculty we have a different, for every subject we have a different faculty. For example, there are some subjects which are GATE and UGC common subjects. So most of those subjects are taught maybe by me, right? If you see the subject like mathematics and fuzzy logic, mathematics is taught by Amit sir, he's from IIT Delhi. Linear programming is also taught by Amit sir. There are some subject that is taught by Abdul sir, there are some subject that is taught by Shubham sir, and there are so many different faculties. There are at least 17 faculties here who have created all the courses, who have created the courses, right? So subject name, topic name, with it you can also mention that you are from UGC NET course or you are from GATE course. That is also recommended, because that way we'll be able to channelize the energy in a specific section only. So when you ask your doubt this way, then I'll be able to send the doubt to the concerned faculty so that you can get the quick resolution of the doubt. Okay, and a part of this, when you send a doubt to us, first thing that we do is we see if this doubt can be solved via email only. So I'll just send you a solution of that doubt. If it cannot be solved, then I'll make a video on that solution of the doubt, and I'll send the solution video to you via email. Or if that also cannot be done, then I'll schedule a Skype class with you and me. So if you, for example, if you are having doubt which needs two-way communication, then I'll be on the Skype with you, or some other faculty will be on the Skype with you, and we'll be resolving their doubts live on the Skype call. Okay, so you can send your doubts at doubts, doubts@gatelectures.com. So it is doubts@gatelectures.com. So whenever you get a doubt, just go through this email and we'll resolve your doubts. Okay, and the last and the not the least is the notifications. That means whenever we add a new video, how we are going to update you, how we are going to inform you. Now, there are multiple ways of telling this. Number one is either we can send you an email. Secondly, we are also creating a Telegram group. So why we are actually creating a Telegram group rather than a WhatsApp group is that in case of WhatsApp group, people can see the contact number of other people, other person, as well as there's a limitation of to how many people you can forward the messages, and there's a lot of unnecessary notifications in case of WhatsApp. Because if generally it happened in the past that we have created a WhatsApp group of the students, now they start sending unnecessary messages, they start sending unnecessary good morning, good night wishes and so on like that, which waste a lot of time, which gives unnecessary notification. But rather than that, what I'm doing is I've created a Telegram group that you can see the link of the Telegram group within this video. Just install Telegram Messenger on your mobile phone, and in that Telegram Messenger search the group. Search our group, you'll see the notification here. And with that Telegram group, when you join it, you'll automatically get a notification from our side. Whenever I'm going to add a new video, I'm just going to post the link of that video in the Telegram group, and you're going to get the notification as soon as it is uploaded. Okay. And secondly, I'm also going to send you emails regarding any updated questions or regarding any updated PDF files or whatever it is there. For example, there's some new good resources to read. I'll send you an email regarding that also. So always read our emails that is sent by us. So I'm going to send you an email. So always read the emails for the latest notifications. Okay. So I hope that I answered all your queries regarding this. And if you have any questions, just let me know. I'll make a video and I'll give you a proper solution on that questions. Okay. And thank you for watching, and all the best while you start learning the course. Thank you so much.